Hello there. So as Michelle said, I'm a medical statistician. This means I spend most of my time locked away and chained to a computer. So it's really nice to see some real people for a change rather than just numbers in a spreadsheet. Okay, so just as every person is unique, every person with Parkinson's presents with a different range of symptoms at varying severities. And these differences, and as a statistician, I would refer to this as heterogeneity across people with Parkinson's, has led many clinicians to believe that there are different subtypes of the disease. So the first paper that looked at this was back in 1999 and was written by Graham. And they did this data-driven approach where they took everyone's symptoms and put it into this statistical algorithm, and then it said whether each patient was identified by one of three distinct subtypes. And since then, a lot of people have seen this paper and thought, oh, this is a really good idea. So in the next 10 years, a rate of about one paper a year, other people used the kind of similar techniques but applied to a slightly different cohort or to a slightly different methodology. And then eventually in 2010, someone came out and wrote this systematic review. And what a systematic review does is it attempts to collate and summarize all the papers that have been published on a particular topic. After they've done this, they can also give recommendations of what a perfect future project might do. And this is to ensure that any new particular publications actually contribute new knowledge to a particular domain. So the five points that this systematic review came out with was one, that we should select a sample of PD patients with similar disease duration, that we should select clinical variables that represent the whole clinical spectrum of Parkinson's, that we should take into account the limitations of cluster analysis techniques, and we should look at the associations between the clusters and clinically meaningful variables, and finally, that we should validate the results in an independent sample. So in 2015, the Discovery cohort published their own take on this kind of cluster analysis that you might have heard Michelle speak about in previous open days. And here we found five subtypes. So going back to these analysis points that they specified in the original systematic review, one, did we select a sample of PD patients with similar disease duration? Well, yes, we did, because all of the individuals in our study were recently diagnosed with the disease. For the second point, I'm sure you'll know from personal experience that we have a huge number of questionnaires that we collect from all of you on an 18-month basis to try and capture the whole clinical spectrum of Parkinson's. And in this paper, we had over 30 variables that went into the analysis. I won't bore you with the third point, did we take into account the limitations of cluster analysis techniques? But yes, we did try to do that. This fourth point, I put in orange, because we did start to look at whether these clusters were related to medication response, but we didn't yet have the follow-up data to see whether it was related to prognosis. So for our next paper, we thought, yes, we should definitely be looking at prognosis as well. And then finally, did we validate the results in an independent sample? No, we did not, but that's what I'm going to speak to you about now. So we turn to our sister study, the Tracking Parkinson's cohort, which is another cohort based in the UK. It's about twice the size of Discovery, but it's based on the same inclusion-exclusion criteria. It's also funded by Parkinson's UK, and it's been running since about 2012 and collects more or less all the same data. So in the past, we have also collaborated with Tracking Parkinson's on other projects, one looking at the use of statins in Parkinson's, and another very statistical one looking at different tests for olfaction and how we can convert between the two. So just to give you an idea of how similar these two cohorts are, you can see that the Tracking Parkinson's cohort and the Oxford Discovery cohort, the average age at diagnosis was virtually identical. Those numbers in the brackets represent the variability. So not only is the average the same, about 66 years, but the variability is very similar. In both cohorts, roughly 35% of the individuals were female, and we had an average disease duration at baseline of just over 1 year. So being a statistician, I couldn't go away without giving you just a little bit of flavor of how this data-driven method works. What we did was something called k-means clustering. And basically here, we've got two continuous variables going from between 0 and 1, and we found three clusters. All of the red dots are closest to the center or the centroid of the red distribution, and we also have the blues and the greens. Just to give you an idea of how complex this is, when we did this in our latest paper, we were working in 12-dimensional space, which I reliably informed means that we're working with larger dimensional space than Doctor Who and the TARDIS. So this is what we found in our latest analysis. Okay, so we found four clusters. And this was a really, this was the nicest graphical way we could try and explain all the important things of these clusters. So we created four concentric circles. The outermost circle is the baseline motor symptoms. The next circle represents the baseline non-motor symptoms, then levodopa response and motor progression. Green is good, although it looks a little bit yellow in this light. Orange is intermediate and red is bad. In this first cluster, they had intermediate baseline motor symptoms. They had very prominent non-motor symptoms. That is a lot of loss of sense of smell or hyposmia, postural hypertension, which is when your blood pressure drops when you stand up, and also cognitive impairment. And this group also had quite poor response to levodopa, and they were the fastest motor progressors. However, coming round to the, the reason why we've ordered them in this way, 1, 2, 3, and 4, is just arbitrarily in order of size. So when we come to look at the second cluster, we can see this is very much a mild disease cluster. They're doing better on their baseline motor and non-motor symptoms, and they also had very good response to levodopa. And when we looked at their motor progression, which I'll show on the next slide, they were kind of in the middle ground. Moving on to the third cluster, this was the group that had the most severe baseline motor symptoms, more postural and gait problems, and also were on much higher doses of levodopa. They also had quite marked non-motor symptoms, mostly in things like psychological well-being, things like depression and anxiety, and also obsessive compulsive disorder problems. So this group here is very much our severe disease group. And when we look at how well they respond to levodopa and their modes of progression, they're more in the middle ground, the intermediates. And finally, going on to our fourth cluster, they were quite average when it came to motor symptoms, except they seemed to show a very tremor-dominant profile. They had quite average non-motor symptoms, poor response to levodopa, but crucially, these individuals were the slowest progressors when we looked at their motor progression. So this is a slide trying to sum up the motor progression. So as Christine was just saying, one way that we have of doing that is using this MDS UPDRS scale. It's the most commonly used scale for looking at motor progression. And we've looked at this over years of diagnosis, and I've looked at this over from 0 to 5 years at diagnosis. When we did this analysis, most individuals had about 3 years of follow-up, but there was also a smaller subset of individuals who had about 6 years of follow-up as well. And at the bottom, I tried to show the average rates of change in UPDRS per year against 1, 2, 3, and 4 clusters. And as you can see across the two cohorts, tracking and discovery, we see quite a similar shape, that this first cluster is progressing much faster, and this fourth cluster is progressing the slowest. So this was our attempt at doing something which is very, very clinically meaningful. I also wanted to give you a flavor of some other things that came out in this cluster analysis. So although we only put in motor and non-motor symptoms to the model, we also found that our clusters were related to other things that didn't go into the model, such as demographics, like age at diagnosis and gender. So you can see that the first and the third clusters tended to be diagnosed much later, whilst this mild disease cluster, the second cluster, were the individuals who tended to be diagnosed earlier. And when we looked at gender, this mild disease cluster was roughly 50% female, but the severe disease cluster was only 25% female. So it looks like the females have it slightly better. Also, we have started to look at some simply analyzed serum biomarkers using the serum that you donated at your baseline appointment. And I've highlighted these two, which came out in the third cluster, which was our severe disease cluster. And you can see that this ApoA1, a polypoprotein, is much lower in this cluster, and also slightly higher in the mild disease cluster. And something called C-reactive protein was much lower in the mild disease cluster and much higher in the severe disease cluster. So the question is, where do we go next with this? Well, we're starting to look at whether our data-derived subtypes are related to genetics, and some of the initial results look quite promising. Also, when we have longer follow-up data, we're going to revisit our longitudinal analysis to see what happens over the long term, say up to 10 years since diagnosis. And just recently, we've had some good meetings, and there are some plans to derive these subtypes within other PD cohorts nationwide. So finally, I just wanted to say a sincere thank you to everyone for giving up your time and making all of these analyses possible.